I've come to you this morning with a message entitled, You Shall Live. You shall live. And we tasted the goodness of the Lord this morning. See, in His presence is fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore. Despite our circumstances, despite what we're facing, when you're in the presence of God, all those things tend to fade away and fall by the wayside. And His Spirit can begin to refresh you and renew you and rebuild you and strengthen your faith for this journey.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I'm coming from Ezekiel 37. The book of Ezekiel 37, starting at verse 1. The author of this book is Ezekiel himself, and his name means God strengthens. And Ezekiel was a prophet who needed the strength of God on his journey. His ministry was not an easy one. It had much opposition. And we can learn something from Ezekiel. Because despite what Ezekiel faced, he did not give up.
Yes.
He continued to believe God. And barely anyone believed him. Everyone that he spoke to was in much opposition and very hard-hearted in their hearts. It was a hostile ministry that he was in. The people were hostile towards Ezekiel. But he kept believing God. He kept the word of God that God has spoken hidden in his hearts. And as people of God living in the day and the age that we live in, where evil is said good and good is said to be evil, we need to stand as Ezekiel stood in the strength and the power and the anointing of God. Because
yes, yes.
I'm not telling you that this journey is going to be an easy one.
Right.
But it's going to be worth it in the end.
Amen.
It's going to be worth it when we see Jesus face to face. It's going to be worth it just like last night. I've seen scores of kids baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. And see, I don't want to stay in yesterday and build a tabernacle there. God is coming to meet your need this morning. He has come to do the impossible in this body this morning and meet your need. In Ezekiel 37, it says, the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of a valley which was full of bones and caused me to pass around about them. And behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. And again he said unto me, prophesy upon these bones, and say unto them, O you dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you and bring up flesh upon you and cover you with skin and breathe in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. exceeding great army.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I know that was a lot of scripture, but I needed you to get the whole picture of what Ezekiel was looking at. God revealed this to Ezekiel. And I just want to think about the man Ezekiel for a moment. He had such a close intimacy with the Lord that God was able to trust him with what he was about to show him. See, the condition of the church right now, this is the condition of the body of Christ. Void of the Spirit of God. Not able to operate in the Spirit of God. Not placing their faith in the correct object, which is the blood of Jesus Christ and what he did on Calvary. See, we were singing about this morning. I am free. I am free. But it's not just a song. You are free by the blood of Jesus Christ. So when the enemy comes in like a flood and tells you that you're still the same person, you tell him, no, I'm free because of the blood of Jesus Christ. You have to place your object of faith, place your eyes back on Jesus and what he has done for you.
Amen.
Ezekiel was so close to the Lord that he heard the heartbeat of God. And you're getting the truth in this church.
Amen.
The Spirit of God is moving in this church. And he is raising you up to be an exceedingly great army. Even you children. An exceedingly great army that you can tell others how to access the presence of God and the power of God, that others may be able to be raised up as an exceedingly great army. He said, and the hand of the Lord was upon me. The hand of the Lord is upon this church.
Yes.
The hand of the Lord, think about that. The hand of God who created heaven and who created earth is upon you.
Hallelujah.
The hand of God who opened up the Red Sea is upon you. The hand of God that shut the mouth of lions is upon you. The hand of God that defeated the enemies of Israel is upon you. The hand of God is upon you and is upon this church.
Thank you, Jesus.
He says, this hand carried me out.
Yes.
The Spirit of the Lord sat me down in the midst of a valley. See, a lot of the times we wonder why we're in the circumstance or the situation that we're in. Nothing, it's either allowed by God or ordained by God.
Mm-hmm.
Either way, the hand of the Lord is upon you.
Amen.
So whatever you find yourself in, he is with you in that place. But in this specific vision, he set him down in the middle of a valley. And I want you to see this because right when Jesus, as an example, Jesus was baptized with the Holy Spirit, it says he was driven in Mark 1:12, and immediately after he was baptized with the Holy Spirit, the Spirit drove him into the wilderness to be tempted for 40 days by Satan, and was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. See, the Spirit of the Lord sat Ezekiel down in this valley. The same Spirit of God that drove Jesus into the wilderness for 40 days. Well, why would God allow that? Why does God allow trials? Why does God allow circumstances and situations? Why doesn't Why does he leave me and set me down in the midst of this valley? Because he wants to build your faith. Because he wants you to rely on the grace of God. He wanted Jesus, even though he was God, not to rely on his deity, but as a man, to rely on the power of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
He was to be an example to you and I.
That's good, yeah.
Not to rely on his deity. He had to rely on the power of the Spirit.
Yes.
Man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. We must be in this book. We must know what God says about our circumstance and our situation, because our feelings are going to lie to us.
Yes.
Right.
Our own minds are going to lie to us.
Yes.
People in the church are going to tell you to give up. People even in the church are going to ask you why you're going this way and that way. Your family is going to say, why are you following God? You're going to come up against all kinds of opposition. And Jesus came up against Satan himself. But he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. He relied on the Spirit of God. And at the end of those 40 days, it said he came out in power.
Hey,
he came out of that temptation. He came out of that trial. He came out of that waxing stronger and stronger and stronger. So you want to know what you're doing in that valley? You're learning how to live for God.
Yes.
You're learning how to rely on his power and how to rely on his word and believe. See, it's one thing to sit in here and listen to Pastor Matt and listen to the preachers that come up even on the radio or read your word, but it's another thing to apply the word of God to your everyday life and allow it to do a work inside of your heart, because God wants to strengthen your faith.
Yes,
see, an army has to go through some training.
Yes. Yes.
An army has to go through some battles. An army even has to please pray for one another.
Yes.
Stick together.
Yes. Yes.
Build one another up in the faith. I try to tell my girls, I'm over 30 girls at Jimmy Swagger Bible College, and I tell them all the time, link arms.
Yes.
Grab a hold of one another. Pray for one another. Be in unity in the Spirit.
Yes.
Build each other up. Don't tear each other down, because we're in this together.
Yes.
See, we're all going through something. You're not the only one in the valley. You're not the only one that the enemy has tried to corner off and isolate, but he'll tell you you are the only one.
Right.
But I'm telling you, there's somebody sitting right next to you that's going through something very, very similar. So we need each other in the body of Christ.
Yeah.
So you wonder why you find yourself in this valley? It's because you must go through the valley to get to the higher plane.
Amen.
In order to grow in the Lord, we're going to have to go through some things.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just because we get saved doesn't mean everything's going to be easy. It's not. It's not going to be easy. But the hand of the Lord is upon you. So don't forget that. The hand of the Lord that caused the Jordan to dry up and for the children of Israel to walk across is upon you. The hand of the Lord that was with the three Hebrew boys in the fire and they did not get burned, that hand is upon you. And the Spirit of God is leading and guiding and directing your life, that you may know him.
Amen.
See, he wants you to know him. And I want you to remember this. His grace is sufficient.
Amen.
It's sufficient. Before your problem even got there, his grace got there first.
Hallelujah.
His grace is sufficient. His strength is made perfect in our weakness.
Mm.
It's okay to humble yourself before God.
Yes.
And say, I can't do it.
Amen.
But you can.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm in this valley and I don't see a way out, but I know that you have the answer and you're going to see me through this valley, and you see the other side and you see the greater picture and you see the higher plane, and I'm just going to wait right here till Jesus comes. I'm just going to wait right in this spot till Jesus comes and allow his presence to be enough.
Yes.
Allow him to satisfy you and allow him to be enough. It was full of bones, this valley, which signifies death. If we place our faith in anything else,
right,
other than what Christ has done for us,
mm-hmm,
other than the blood of Jesus, you tie the hands of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit cannot work if we are looking and placing our faith in anything else. If we make something else more important or a priority over the Lord, we begin to have some death in our lives and in our spirit. We become void. See, the church as a whole, I'm not talking about this body here, but the church as a whole has become void of the Spirit. It's as the glory of God is lifted up above the temple, and it's not able to move freely within the body of Christ like it should, or like he wants to, or like he desires to dwell in the midst of his people, because we haven't learned how to access the things of God like we should. And that's why this body in this place and this remnant is important, because as we learn how to live for God, we can teach others how to live for God. And as the power of God moves freely through us, the power of God can touch others.
Amen.
It's like a fire that ignites and spreads.
Yes.
So revival must start here.
Yes, Lord.
But if we allow idols and put things more important than the Lord and our relationship with God, I'm not talking about doing things for God. I'm talking about knowing him. I'm talking about sitting with him. And I'm not talking about works righteousness, but when you're in love with someone, you want to sit with them. You want to talk to them. You want to hear what they have to say to you. In relationship.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. But there's good news, because in the midst of the bones, there was a but God moment.
Hey.
Even though it was full of bones and Ezekiel was in this place, it looked dry. It looked like there was no hope. Have you ever been in a circumstance or a situation or are facing one right now?
Right.
That you're saying, I have no idea how I'm going to get through this. I have no idea how this bondage or this mindset or this thought that keeps running through my mind or this relationship is going to be healed or restored. I don't know how my family is going to get saved. I don't know how my children are going to get saved. It just looks impossible. It looks dead, full of dry bones. But God.
Hallelujah.
See, but God.
Yes.
But God was still in the midst of them. He calls them. God calls Ezekiel to pass around and about them. See, as ministers of the word of God, we have discernment and we're able to look out and see the condition of the people. We look around and about them. See, always have eyes to see one another.
Right.
Through the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Don't look with a critical eye.
Come on.
Look with the love of God.
Yeah.
And remember what you did 10 minutes ago.
Come on.
Okay?
Yeah.
Remember what happened about a week ago or a month ago that happened to you. Mercy triumphs over over judgment.
Amen.
And Ezekiel was able to look with eyes of mercy and look at the condition of these dry bones. See, you're getting the truth here. But there are those out there that need the truth.
Yes.
And they need to know. And they might be living some way you just don't agree with. But look with eyes of mercy and compassion. And it should make you run to them.
Yes.
It shouldn't make you stick your nose in the air and run away from them.
Right.
It should make you run with arms of love and say, I remember being there.
Right.
I remember being down. Strung out on drugs.
Yeah.
I remember being in jail. I remember being in that condition. I remember being so legalistic that I was such a Pharisee that you couldn't tell me a thing,
right.
And I was right about everything.
That's right. Come on.
So either way, I've tasted all of it.
That's right.
But the blood of Jesus is the best way. And when you can begin to look at people that way, you'll be able to be moved with compassion.
Yes,
Lord.
And you'll be able to answer as Ezekiel did. See, God spoke to him and said, "Son of man, can these bones live?" Ezekiel didn't sit there staring at the bones. Think about this. How many times do we come up against something in our valley, and all we can do is stare at the valley?
Yeah.
And you sit there and you stare at the valley and you stare at the circumstance and you look at the people that are in the circumstance,
right,
and they just
get
bigger and bigger and the problem gets worse and worse.
Amen.
But Ezekiel didn't do that. See, I want to go through this real quick. There were many different valleys that are in the Bible. There was the valley of Baraka, where the enemies of Judah had been defeated. There was the valley of the shadow of death. See, it's just a shadow of death.
Right.
You are going to come through that valley. There was the valley that shall be exalted. That means that God is going to prepare a way in your valley.
Mm-hmm.
There's a valley of weeping.
Yeah.
I know I found myself
mm-hmm.
in the valley of weeping. But God will make that valley a well of water.
That's good, yeah.
See, there was a valley of Rephaim. The Lord of the breakthrough.
Mm-hmm.
See, God is going to break through in the midst of your valley. There was a valley of Achor, which was a door of hope. See, we look at the valley all the time as a bad thing, but there's a door of hope that you're going to be able to walk through at the end of that valley. The valley of Elah, where Goliath had been defeated. See, your Goliath is already defeated. That circumstance is already defeated. It's already finished. There was a valley of Elion where the sun stood still. Come on. We serve a God that can cause the sun to stand still. What can he do for you?
Yes.
So when Ezekiel was presented with this question, he already knew.
Yeah.
He had remembered what God had done for him. See, in our current circumstance, we tend to forget how far God has already brought us from.
Yeah.
How many circumstances he's already seen us through.
That's right.
How many trials he's already brought us through. How many fires we haven't got burned in yet.
Yeah.
How many Goliaths he already cut down. How much sin he's already broken in our lives, and bondages already broken in our lives.
Yeah.
That family member that you didn't think could be saved is saved.
Hallelujah.
Okay, so many circumstances that he's already brought us through.
Yeah.
But the enemy would like to the dry bones. He looked at his God. He looked at his God. And he answered, knowing that his God can do the impossible. He answered him in faith and said, oh Lord God, you know. You know the circumstance. You know the situation. I know that you know and you're able to bring this to completion. See, he was promised in Ezekiel 36 that they would get a new heart, that they would get a new spirit, that they would be filled with the Spirit of God. So before this vision even came about, the promise had been there. See, God has given you some promises
yes.
that you're still holding on to, that you're still believing. And I'm here to encourage you, don't quit and don't give up. Yes. And keep pressing and keep believing. Because God is going to bring that promise to fulfillment. Mm-hmm. Don't stop, don't quit, and don't give up. We have to believe and stand upon the word of God. And he said, you know. So I ask you and I challenge you today and myself, are we answering our situations in faith? Mm. Are we looking at our problem or are we looking how great our God is? Are we hanging our heads in fear and doubt and defeat? Are we standing up in the power and the anointing and the authority, not in us, but upon the word of God and believing that these dry bones shall live. He says in verse 4, and again he said unto me. See, God's giving us instructions. These weren't just instructions for Ezekiel, but they're also instructions for us. He's given the promise, now he gives the instructions. And he said unto me, prophesy upon these bones and say unto them, O you dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. See, the instructions were to prophesy. Prophesy meant to speak under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. I have good news. You have authority to speak under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to your
thank you.
And he says, the Lord God said unto these bones, be behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. Behold, and the Lord has been telling me this for a long time. Behold meant to see. See, he's going to make your faith sight.
Hallelujah.
Whatever it is, whatever you've been crying out for, whatever you believe in God for, you will see it. If you can continue to believe it, you're going to see it with your eyes. And it's going to be one of those moments where you can only say it was only God. It was only that the doctors say are impossible. It's impossible. It's impossible. But I just keep feeling like that woman with the issue of blood that crawled on her knees all the way past the crowd to touch the hem of Jesus' garment, that the virtue and the power of God would flow from my Savior. And I'm not going to stop believing until I see it with my eyes. I'm not going to give up until God touches me. And then I'm going to believe for the next thing. And believe for the next thing. Because believing never stops.
Amen.
You continue to believe your God.
Yes.
If he saved you from sin.
Yes.
If he set you free from sin. How much more will he do for his child?
Mm-hmm.
Think about that. How much would you do for your children? He saved you while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. He's not done with you yet. He's not done.
Hallelujah.
He's just beginning. You shall live. Live in the Hebrew meant to live or to revive. So many times the enemy comes in and will tell you it's too late. But God. See, he'll tell you, game over. You fail too many times. Your family is too far gone, but God. See, your children are too far gone, but God. That sickness is too far gone, but God. But God. See, he comes in and says, checkmate. The enemy says, checkmate, you're done. But the blood of Jesus comes in and washes and cleanses and picks you back up again. And there's that, but God, revelation you have in that valley. And that God is able to even raise up the bottom of the valley if he has to make it a plain to bring you through.
Yes, Lord.
It says, you shall live. So if anybody has felt like I'm in a dry place, or I don't even know if God is with me any longer, or I haven't seen this circumstance turn around and it's been 10 years, 15 years, 3 years, sometimes a month can feel like 10 years to us, okay, 2 days, I haven't seen it turn around yet, but God says, you shall live.
Amen.
You shall live. He wants to revive us in this place and renew his promises to us. He's going to turn it around. It says, I will lay sinews upon you and bring flesh upon you, and shall cover your skin and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. He's going to turn it around. He's going to turn it around for his glory. He's going to turn it around. He said, you'll know that I am the Lord. And others around you, see, it wasn't just Ezekiel that saw it. All the dry bones seen it too. And anybody that was looking from the outside was going to see it too.
Yes, yes.
See, when I got set free from drugs, my family seen it.
Yes.
And though they may deny God himself, they can't deny
Amen.
The power of God in my life.
Amen.
Because I am no longer the same person
Hallelujah.
That I used to be.
Amen.
going to die this way, then this is the way that I'm going to die. And I was okay with that because to me there was no hope. There was none at all. But God had a different plan for my life.
Yes,
and you think he can't interrupt you in a dark place? He came into Atlanta County Jail and bust down the doors and said, I'm going to bring you out of here.
Thank you.